Does walking lower high blood sugars immediately? Can diabetes be controlled or even reversed by adding this simple lifestyle change? New studies, which will be covered today, explain how an easy, very short, light walk at the right time can be a game changer for not only blood sugar control, but for lowering blood pressure and preventing heart disease. However, the addition of this effortless small change can only come to fruition if you objectively understand the connection to your hemoglobin A1C. But before we begin, please do not forget to subscribe and hit that gray notification bell. That way, you will be alerted when new life-changing episodes have been published. And most importantly, if you've learned something new or revolutionary today, and that is what this channel is all about, keeping you on the forefront of science, then please hit that like button for me. The one thing we as diabetics all know, controlling blood sugars is the single most important task we have at living that long, healthy life free of any complications. The confused questions we initially face: first, what lifestyle changes impact control the most? For example, exercise or walking, and we will get to that in just a few moments. And second, what are the ideal blood sugars we as diabetics should shoot for as a result of these lifestyle changes? And as you may already know, the answer to these questions have been overly complicated and are all over the place. The reasons: corruption and politics for one. Second, the pushing of personal agendas for profits. And unfortunately, the huge egos of many of these so-called elite educated experts. Some doctors, like the great Dr. Bernstein, believe and practice all diabetics, both type 1s and type 2s, have the right to non-diabetic numbers. That means always keeping that A1C at 5 and under. And in my humble opinion, I agree 1001%. And then you also have the medical establishment wanting and encouraging an A1C in the 6s. Like my doctors, especially my endocrinologist, who wants me at 6.5. Who's right? Who's wrong? Your quality of life depends on that concrete answer. If you've been following me, then you know I became a late onset type 1 insulin dependent diabetic due to an autoimmune attack. This occurred 8 to 9 years ago. What scares me the most? We diabetics have historically a much shorter lifespan than our peers. And for many, many diabetics, this disease inevitably becomes a very painful and debilitating journey. This is why diabetes is called by the so-called experts a progressive disease, which means for many, it just gets worse and worse. And the only options are more medications pile onto more medications. I do not want to die 15 to 20 years earlier. I do not want heart disease, impending neuropathy, gastroparesis, loss of eyesight, loss of limbs, or even be put on dialysis. And I've mentioned this in other episodes, but if you have not noticed, there are new dialysis centers popping up everywhere. They are on just about every street corner and even in most shopping malls. And who are they catering to? It's us diabetics. All that eventually comes when blood sugars are kept in those non-diabetic ranges above 5. Evidence is mounting that sugars, even in the pre-diabetic ranges, causes damage. And clearly, our experts cherry-pick data to keep the coffins flowing. For example, this prospective study done in Japan clearly demonstrates that an elevated hemoglobin A1C in the pre-diabetic ranges is a significant risk factor for the development of cardiovascular disease, especially strokes. The risks of cardiovascular disease and strokes were significantly higher in subjects with A1Cs of greater than 5.5 compared to those with an A1C of less than 5. Knowing this, we can now get to our main questions. Walking. How can we use this simple tool to help reduce blood sugars and ultimately our A1Cs so that diabetes no longer becomes that progressive disease? To begin with, it's difficult to exactly say how much a person's blood sugars will drop. Variables include walking intensity, walking duration, your current lean muscle reserves, as well as the quantity and types of foods you are currently eating. And most importantly, as you will learn today, when you walk in relation to the time that you've eaten. Let me explain some facts first and go over some exercise physiology so your grasp of knowledge grows. Glucose is one of the major fuel sources during exercise. Its uptake by skeletal muscle can increase by up to 50-fold, but intensity and duration are the key determinants of how much glucose gets absorbed. Put simply, when you exercise, muscle membranes become more efficient. As the heart pumps more glucose-containing blood to your muscles, changes in chemical enzymes occur, further aiding in glucose transport. With all these mechanisms occurring simultaneously, our muscles soak up the glucose they need to contract, and our blood sugars drop. What's more, while your body typically needs insulin to get glucose into the muscle cells, exercise allows muscle tissue to absorb glucose without insulin. Therefore, it reduces the insulin secretion response to glucose rises after meals. This is ideal, especially for insulin-resistant type 2 diabetics, because you already have that failing, burnt-out pancreas. We want to keep insulin levels under control as much as possible. High insulin levels or hyperinsulinemia over time is what really leads to insulin resistance, heart disease, and early death. Now, to our million-dollar question of the day. Does intensity and duration of the walk matter after you eat? Low to moderate intensity activity like brisk walking is best for keeping glucose levels in check after eating. One reason for that is that when you walk, it depends on aerobic metabolism. This mechanism draws upon glucose in combination with fatty acids and protein from the body. So when you take that walk after eating, you will burn through the glucose at a moderate rate. Keeping that walk at low intensity helps curb the promotion of additional glucose produced by our livers. On the other hand, high intensity exercise relies on anaerobic metabolism, which draws upon glucose as its only fuel source. Because glucose availability in muscles is very limited, vigorous exercise stimulates the counter-regulatory hormones, the catabolic hormones, that prompt the liver to produce glucose to meet that rising energy demand, resulting in elevated blood sugar readings. When researchers studied older adults with prediabetes, they found a 15-minute easy to moderate walk after every meal curbed blood sugar spikes all day. In other words, a little exercise can make a big difference. This study, published in Diabetes Care, found that 3 very short walks each day after meals were effective at reducing blood sugars over a 24-hour period as a single 45-minute walk at the same pace. The study had them walk at 3 miles per hour on a treadmill for about 15 minutes. This was done about half an hour after every meal. The researchers observed that the evening post-meal walk was the most effective at lowering blood sugar levels for a full 24 hours. The best part? That walk curbed blood sugar rise as soon as the participants started to walk on the treadmill. So what am I saying? The time has come to get up from the table, tie on those walking shoes, and take a little stroll around the block. After dinner is a great time to get up and walk with a family member, a neighbor, or even take the dog for a walk. But you must manage the intensity. The bottom line, you eat your meal, you wait about half an hour, then you go for that light 15-minute walk. If you are new to walking after meals, then begin with a relaxed stroll. You may over time be able to generally increase the speed and intensity as the body becomes accustomed to physical activity. However, this is critical to understand. The walking we are talking about is not a prescription for weight loss. It is a prescription for controlling blood sugars. If you need more motivation to pursue normal blood sugars, consider this. Based on new studies, after studies, after studies, heart attack risk more than doubles at blood sugar levels considered to be in the pre-diabetic ranges. This really explains why many people who have heart attacks do not have high cholesterol levels. The vast majority of doctors pay very little attention to the actual post-meal blood sugars in their patients. However, research now conclusively shows that the magnitude of blood sugar rises after meals directly correlates with you having heart attacks. If you do have diabetes, what does this mean for you? It means the best thing you can do to avoid getting heart disease or to slow its development, especially if you're in the early stages, is to prevent that post-meal blood sugars from rising over normal limits. That also means doing whatever you can to keep blood sugars under 140 milligrams per deciliter after every meal. And in my case, I personally limit my post-meal levels to no more than 110 to 120 the most. And may I add, it has to be below 100 within 1 to 2 hours. Walking soon after eating is that very powerful tool you can add to that arsenal that not only limits those post-meal glucose levels, but if done right, can reduce the stress hormones like cortisol. This is one of those hormones released through stress. So a simple walk, even in the park, can quickly reduce it, which improves mood, positively impacting emotional health. Lastly, and just as important, a simple walk can lower your LDL cholesterol and that all-important blood pressure readings. Knowing all this, how do we put this all together to get you started? It all begins with the right walking shoes, especially for those of you who've had elevated blood sugars over extended periods of time. Protecting your delicate feet is priority number one. Then take it one step at a time, literally. A good way to start something new is to take it slow and set achievable goals and then make it more ambitious over time. If you don't walk at all right now, make it a goal to walk 1 minute per day. Next week, aim for 2 minutes a day until you get it to 15 minutes after your meal. My additional tip for the day, if you are going out to eat, I want you to deliberately park your car the furthest you can away from the restaurant so that you have to walk after the meal. After you've worked your way up to that easy 15-minute walk after dinner, I want you to build from there. Next, I would add in another 15 minutes of fasted walking first thing in the morning. That's what I do to keep my A1C at 5 and under. Every morning when I get out of bed, I immediately make my cup of coffee and drink it while I check my emails, and then I do my fasted cardio. That simple cardio session adds to my insulin sensitivity like you would not believe. That keeps me extra lean and muscular too, which means less insulin has to be used for the day, so there's less bodily inflammation. I want you to remember our number one rule as resilient diabetics. Always let thy food be your medicine. Good food is medicine. Bad food will need you to take more and more medicine. And what do I mean by that? It is your diet of choice, first and foremost, that will make or break your health. You can't outrun, or in our case, outwalk a bad diet. If you'd like to learn more, I'll create a playlist for you on the foods that heal and the foods that make diabetes progressively worse, requiring you to take more and more medications. The first link you will see is to subscribe to this all-important life-changing channel. The second is the link on the playlist about foods. Have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another new episode, which are generally released bi-monthly. Bye for now.